Every single Hasgeek talk of mine has had technical difficulties. This is no different, so I've vaguely prepared for it. So FML, the name of the talk, all that's well and good, but this is actually going to go a little more deeper. So I'll tell you, over the past few months, I've been thinking about content management systems, which is to say I had to log into Drupal once and decided I don't ever want to do that. And here's the problem with content management systems, okay? In a company where you're doing content management, magazine, whatever, there are too many types of content. For example, in Myntra, there's like banners and layouts and stuff for the devices. There's little style tips that show up when you search for something. I don't know if that's still live. There might be some configuration. We are opening up our new premium brand shop, so we have to save like layouts for the thing again. So very many different types of things. And if you try to build them in one CMS, nothing yet? Oh, it's still starting up. Okay, I need to talk to my boss. Right, so the problem then is because you have all of that and you try shoving it into the same CMS, the next project that comes and says, oh, by the way, it needs to be a little different, you're screwed. Like you have to actually, like you spend your lifetime building the CMS. Instead, what, like it's a different angle I'm trying to take, is I'm trying to build libraries and helpers for content management systems. Like, okay, fine, you have a new project and you need a data store, you need to store something, you need an API to it, and you need a way to quickly render it. So vague philosophy behind how it should be stored and how you should output it out to people and all that jazz. Don't count this in my 15 minutes. No? Array, yaar, it's beach balling on the Apple screen. Okay, whatever, I'll just keep talking. You guys have already paid, right? So the cheap jokes get the best laughs. So these are libraries and helpers for content management systems. So for example, in my head, I just want node module, which helps me connect to a collection of data and get lists and query and offset size. You guys have built like REST APIs. So I want that automatically. I want to be able to quickly generate like forms for people to edit stuff. So this is where the human part comes in. Now, if it was just machines to talk to each other, I don't give a shit. But like the actual format of the document itself now matters because a marketing guy is changing it at 3 a.m. He can't call me up and say, what the hell is it saying commas missing in JSON? He can't edit JSON. We made him try, but he can't. Dude, like it's refusing to start up with the thing connected. I'm just pulling this bit out for a second. Let's do a hard restart, hold on. It's okay, lunch isn't that great, I asked. I'll say whatever I have to, okay, right now. This is all blank air. Yeah, dude, trust my computer. Just, why does Apple do these things? Apple is asking my phone whether it should trust its other brother computer that it's connected to. What gave it away? The big cable connecting it? So, and so, whatever. Okay, so I have slides though. I don't do this fancy JavaScript slides thing. I bought the laptop, I'll use it. Keynote, that's the one. Dude, I'm just being honest, you guys can laugh at it, but I figured I have to figure out a way for other people to buy me fancy computers. If I have to learn JavaScript to do it, then I'll do it. Are you getting any video feed? What the hell, dude? Is this the same one that I was using yesterday? Okay, you're getting video feed now? Okay, now? How? You tell me what I'm doing wrong. I'm just standing up here. You have to tell me what I'm doing wrong, at least. Do you want me to just turn my laptop around to these guys? Do you get your complimentary binoculars in the inserts? All of it. You asked me to do a demo code thing, so I have demo code. Okay, no, because it's telling me that it's found, like it's on two displays. So I don't know what I'm doing wrong. Are you sure you're checking the right channel? Huh? Yeah, this, whatever this Apple adapter thing is. Do you have another? Oh, brilliant. Yeah, let's try that. Okay, now does it show a video feed? Again? Not sure how another adapter will help them. Scary. I kind of buried the lead also by telling you guys the intro. Now you're like, yeah, okay, CMS is not interesting at all. They're not. Okay, all right. Yeah, that should do. Okay, and here we go. Ready? Okay, tell me you're getting something now, man. Hey, it's... You gotta try this in the beginning instead of asking me to fix a tech problem. I'm no good at it. Okay, something surprising. How long a while do you suppose? Oh my gosh. Oh, and my time starts now. Okay, cool. So as I was saying, so FML is cool, like as a data format, as something we figured, but it's stupidly easy. Like in one slide, you'll know what it is, and you'll say, okay, that's a good idea. You will. And then we'll move on. So basically, content management systems for the 21st century. What are the things that we need? Before we do that, let's quickly talk about some buzzwords, what content actually means. So content is different from your any other row of data in your database by the very fact that a human is going to be interacting with it. Now, there are layers of abstraction on it. So for example, MS Word will give you a nice UI and generate the shitty XML syntax. SVG is nice. They're again like little tags. But content in itself is like of 50 types. Okay, it might be in Markdown. It might be in this. It might be in that. So first, you have to think about like the first stage of content management is the creation part of it. So every single thing I talk about, I'm going to talk about in two terms. One is like how humans interact with it and how computers interact with it. And I want to solve both problems, because that's frankly my day-to-day work and I need to figure that out. So content is, you can imagine like an A4 sheet of paper with stuff written on it. This is my artwork, like it's like beautifully aligned and all that, so that's nice. But specifically, like I did it this way to show you that, okay, fine, like a letter, it might have some metadata attached to the data. And this is not stored in another field. Like if you start doing that, no, you say you have a field which is data and then you store meta fields in other data and all. Essentially, I think in a document, you could consider that it's part of the same thing, okay? It's cool. And they can be of a bunch of formats. You could write in JSON or YAML or XML or Markdown or plain text or binary. So like binary, I've started. So for me, like an image is content, but I don't really want to write it to my document format. So instead, I assume that it's like a URL. And I assume, yeah, that URL is pointing to an image. So weak abstraction, but it works, okay? Like you can just store data as URLs. Anyway, my URLs are coming from CDN. I know they're not changing. So the problem with this is, no, like if you're building a content management system, then like you have to, at least with like some of these types, you have to write the format in the thing. And like I said, like, metadata isn't even in the document. So first thing I propose, and this is like, it's not even like an original thing, it's this concept of front matter. So if you guys have used like GitHub pages, anyone here used GitHub pages? Yeah, right? They have a little language where in between these three dashes, you can pass in data in YAML format. YAML is easy, it looks like this. I'll show you an example in a second. And you type in some other key value pairs, and then you type in the body of your document. So as an example, I'll say format markdown, author Sunil Pai, and I am editing this human interface. There's no JSON or anything. I like markdown syntax, so I did this. So that actually said 4chan first, but I realized I had to put it out there. So anyway, you could say that this is a document. This is the entire thing. So to a human, this is how it looks. And if you pass it through a compiler, which you could do in like a little while right now, it'll end up becoming JSON. So this is good like for my machine to talk to. So I'll store it in that FML format. I haven't thought of a full form for FML yet. So if you guys have any ideas, write it down. So it just says FML. So as a computer, like when I'm talking to the database, I'm not really talking to the raw form. I make it pass through a function which converts it into this JSON. And now that I have a format thing, I can live like figure out which compiler to use. So if I'd used like format JSON, then it would have picked up one JSON parser and made one JSON object. Markdown is fine. I'll leave it as text and so on. Okay. So, excellent. So now you ask yourself, as a computer, first question, how do I talk to these things? I think like a very simple API looks something like this. There'll be a collection. You'll say dot set my first blog post some document string, which you'll get from an input form. At any point of time, you want to get a particular key. Assume all of these take callbacks. I just got tired of writing callback the whole time. But yeah, you'll like get for a given key what the document stored at it is, and query it based on something. Like find all blog posts that reference the word guitars. So yeah, this is the API like for content as like collections. We'll go like a little more complicated, but in essence, you say that this is the API. So now once you have a simple API around this content, you can start building stuff on top of it. Okay, that being said, this is where it starts getting interesting, okay? So like layouts are a special kind of document. And this happens, of course, at Myntra. Like these guys want to change the layout of the homepage, add stuff, remove stuff. It has to flow a particular way. There's a carousel with three images and all that jazz. So one thing that it has that it's not that's not common with like all types of data is it's fairly tree-oriented, right? You can express HTML as a tree, and you can think like HTML is a tree, and that's a good way for us to understand what these guys are thinking about when they're making their layouts. They're like, they want one big block container, and they have like a little bit of, they have a carousel with like three images, and they think of it as a tree, like those are the pieces. Sometimes communication happens like across these components, but that's not the important bit now, like solved problem anyway. But the idea is that, okay, fine, there are like tree-style layouts. So it turns out that JSON is really sucky for storing tree-type structure because A, like if you're a human who's editing it, either like you have to come up with like your own custom key name. So for example, not this one. Hold on, we'll get to that. So this is our first cut at a JSON that we used for our Android layouts, okay? Like we had page and it gets a title and there's tab name, sections, and there's a banner thing which takes image URL, which is different from some other image, and so on. So like this is fairly, it's a good first attempt, but it doesn't like really represent the tree nature of the thing. So what we actually want is a data format, at least like for a computer to talk to, that looks like this. So what it's actually doing is you can imagine this as XML being converted into JSON, okay? They'll have each node will have a type, so that's your tag name, some props which are like attributes, and children nodes that you pass to it. So you do this consistently, you see like all the keys are essentially the same. Specific components get like props. But again, I can't expect the marketing guy to do this. So enter JSX. So I'm so sorry becoming like a React fanboy and all, but I'm like stealing ideas from them for some specific things. React wanted to do components with their, not MVC framework, whatever, their Vue framework. And they looked at a bunch of things and APIs and all, and they said, no, like we want to be able to write something that looks like a component structure, like HTML, and make it break down to like JavaScript. So I'll show you a quick like demo of what it looks like, okay? How this JSX converts to JavaScript. Okay, demo gods, oh yes. My tabs are closed. Okay, hold on. I'm pretty sure I have a screenshot somewhere. Yeah. Hold on. Live editing, sorry. Didn't plan on it at all. So this is what this is how I want those guys to be able to lay out the page. I have a sample, though, of course. Why am I doing this to myself? Come on, open up. Oh, it's opening there, is it? Hold on. So project's name is Mixtape. And wait, let me just sneak it away from you for a quick second. So, Yeah, hold on, don't worry. Yeah, cool. Oh, sweet, okay, so I have the actual ones that I planned on showing you. So this is how I want them to be able to write the code. It looks like HTML, but like custom tags, like layout and tabs, those obviously don't exist. And then I want to convert that to JSON. So I picked JSX because what it does is, oh, brilliant. Now my connection is, because I had to disconnect it that time. Count to 10, guys. So let's just go back to that sample. Okay, so I want to take this, but further I want like a little more flexibility, which is to say I want to be able to pull off stunts like this as well. So do you see like what's the difference here? Like I'm actually embedding JavaScript into the thing, which is slightly weird. You've seen this in like templating languages. But what I'm actually doing is like returning real components. There's no string manipulation that you get from somewhere else, or no two string implementation. No, I can actually write code like this, and JSX like just lets me do that. Oh, look, this thing actually opened. I want to show you like what the compiled JavaScript looks like when you actually. I pissed off the demo gods as a child, I think. Like, so I don't have a way to make up for it. Right? So if you type it in like this, it gets converted into JavaScript like this. Very regular JavaScript. The tag names become function names, and the props become like little hashes, and all the children that you pass to it go down as further arguments to your function. Simplest abstraction that works. Cool. So what? Let's just go back to my slides. And okay, so that's the idea, okay? So like JSX, you can use it to describe tree structures in JavaScript, and we abuse that to be able to like write JSON to us. These guys are thinking I'm going to use this to generate the React components, but my first concern is like actually building an API around it. So like I said, we wanted to be able, like this was our first cut, okay? This was the first cut of the JSON. We wanted JSON like this, and we ended up being able to write JSX like this. For a marketing guy who knows like a smattering of HTML, this is the easiest thing in the world. Fair? Like you see it and it like it reads out as it's supposed to be. If you open up your Android Mintra app right now, free, you'll see how this basically corresponds to actual components on the thing. Now there's no JSX running on the Android app. He's just listening to the JSON, which looks like this, and he carries on. It makes it interesting because like it starts influencing the architecture of the components that they're actually talking to. Like your JSON matches very closely to UI components. And that's all I'll say about that, okay? So far so good. JSX I can use for doing layouts. I can pull off a stunts with it. Then we talk about like collections of data. This is very simple, like I'll run through this very quickly. It's a solved database problem. You have a collection of documents, you need to be able to store it and query it and so on. Feel free to use the thing of your choice, MySQL, whatever. So this library lets you like plug in whatever as long as you write a little adapter for that get set query abstraction. Okay, so you could use SQL or parse.com. You could read from the file system directly. So for example, if you want to make a website and store a bunch of markdown files and just spit it out, maybe have a cache, totally works. So the ones that only work right now are like SQL and parse.com, but they're fairly easy to implement, so I've like left it as homework to the readers. More important than the actual storage at this point is the delivery of the thing. All these documents, you have to be able to scale across like a big organization or small organization, whatever. People are going to be wanting to make product requests of your database. So to an engineer, right, these are three different projects. This I assumed are like queries from Zomato because I got tired of talking about Mintra. But I'm assuming that the product managers ask them these three features. We want to be able to show popular restaurants in Bangalore. We want to be able to show recently opened restaurants in Bangalore. And then things that I, the user who opened up the app, might like to eat today. So the second one is obviously newest and added to database. That's simplest to solve. Popular restaurants means now it becomes a big data one. You have to like do queries and check ratings and all that. Things I might like to eat today is a real-time problem. See what his tastes are and like then find restaurants that match that and all. But to a product guy, this is like just one. These are one type of request. I have three tabs. I want to show these three things. What's the big deal? Why does it have to be different features? So that's interesting. And I wanted to talk about it in a little more depth, but frankly, I'm just going to point you to Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is cool for setting up search on your website. So it does like some things out of the box really well, like full text search. You can do stuff like synonym matching. And so for example, I want to be able to show sports related style tips if you search for the word Nike, even though the tips themselves might not search Nike and all that. So I'm really not going to go into any detail about this. Feel free to go to an Elasticsearch conf, do the tutorials. You basically plug it on any data store and gives you a searchable database to it. What interests me more, however, about these documents now is about the way that they talk to each other, or at least reference each other. The references themselves are like of a couple of types, and I'll tell you about that. But I was looking in terms of like data, how databases do it versus how the internet does it. The internet uses hrefs, like anchor tags, and it doesn't even know if the resource exists at the endpoint. In fact, sometimes it points to like dynamic URLs. So there's one type of reference where I know like an ID that I have to talk to you, like go to one inbox ID, do a GET request on it and get it. And then there's like dynamic, like find me, like you should be able to hook into any service, find me shoes that do a bunch, I'll just get to what I mean, okay? I want this to be true, okay? I want to be able to say block, I want to say carousel, dump a bunch of product IDs, and perhaps have a search block as well. Two problems with this. First thing, that thing that JSX actually doesn't contain any more data. It has to talk to a service and get it in whatever format. Second one, this thing does, like, it's slightly harder. Like, assume that there's a search team and all, but again, you have a service that gives you like search results to it, but you're like not really clear about it. You don't know what type of components will come back and stuff. So throw this JSX drama at it and be able to run asynchronous transforms on what the JSON comes back. So what I mean, and I'll demonstrate this to you, you take whatever that JSX you wrote, this JSX, right? Convert it down to first phase JSON, like just parse it, and then run like transforms where you walk down the tree that's generated, and like product ID, I have a little product service that I talk to, pulling whatever props are there from that, and come and shove the data back in. Let's quickly do a demo of that. If this doesn't work, no? Are you serious? That's fine. Make dev, start up my server. So before I get to that, I actually want to show you some code, like what it takes to get here. So this is your first look at like how it happens, okay? Make that big. That's useless. So I made a little JS foo project in this little layouts thing that I'm doing. First thing I do is I set up a little configuration. You guys are having a look at my parse ID and key. That's great. That's not even important. So I set up like what the collection I'm talking to is, which view I want to use, and that's just because like it's a little app that I built around this. How I'm going to compile this? So I have a bunch of components, and I'll show you the components right now. I have a session config. Again, feel free to hack into my laptop, guys. And I can set up like an admin panel for it immediately, where some guy can jump in and edit stuff. Further, let's have a look at like what that actual transform is, because that's an interesting thing to us. It's about this much code. I have a little endpoint where I can get details for products and details for the from the search service. I just pass it to it, take that callback, and add it back to the node that's generated. Is there a password though? No, not really. So what that does is it takes that little bit of JSX that you just saw, and magically just converts it into a big-ass asynchronous function service call. See, like, the product thing has been filled in, so like if I just put this up for a second. So I had three products there with these IDs here. It's just pulled it up, and I have search data, so like a whole bunch of search products and filters and whatever the hell I want. It does that with that one line. Mind you, I haven't, like, fair enough, like, I've made it such that these components are available to these marketing guys, but now I have an API around it. Let's solve the UI problem also. I use React. It works well with this style of JSON. I don't want any arguments about frameworks and all. I'm sorry, it just works. This is how much work I have to do, okay? This is my entire block component. This is my carousel thing into which I dump children. Given a product, like I'm able to like render a little ahref and an image on it, and I have a little search component. There's nothing else. There's no DOM loading and all that. So what I get for that effort is this UI. Like, it's rendered those three products and a whole bunch of search products. Cool thing about this, though, and assuming my net connection works now, is the admin interface that you get is like a live editing thing. So for example, you can take this and move it down, moves the products around. Let's say I want the search stuff before this. It just works. So that's kind of nice. Like, now I have a way. Like, I have a way of like making layouts and arbitrary connections and doing this. So I do this and I save it. I have a little save button over here. And it should work. Saving. Come on. Saving. Save. Please. Oh, okay, it's saved. And then I go to the JSON that's generated for it, and boom. So the search thing is now up on top, and I haven't had to like stitch any APIs together, not making any god-level APIs. And that's cool. So I can do generic stuff. So just quickly back to this. Okay, awesome. So now that's where content has reached. Like, I should be able to save dynamic stuff into the document and not resolve it like until it's asked for. And I should be able to have a way. So eventually, I guess those will be replaced by like drag and drop UIs. But for now, like, it gets a real thing like solved. And the final piece of the puzzle then is like consumption. okay, consumption is fair enough. Like you have a bunch of clients, you have websites, you have iOS apps, you have Android apps. So I want APIs available to this. But you sync with that team and say, yeah, build it in this component way. So all you have to do then is like walk this tree of JSON. It'll tell you what components are where. Stitch those together, and you have an Android app. So Android app right now, totally working on that, fairly scalable. So I'll do a couple of demos as to what is live right now. How much more time do I have? Come on, dude. Like, wasn't my fault. Yeah, exactly. So it's 1:20, so I have 10 more minutes, right? You guys said I have a half-hour talk. I didn't. Layouts. Let's look at what we actually do for the Android app. Oh, the password worked. Okay. So whoever was shuttering through the network looking for basic auth passwords can bring down Myntra right now. So this is what we actually do at Myntra right now. We have a whole language, very simple, about 7 or 8 components. Let's just zoom into it. So yeah, like they're able to like edit like layout and icons and stuff like that. This guy wakes up at 12 o'clock at night. This is a fully functional version of the website right now. So you can choose like a page, going to women, for example, what the women's page look like. Looks like, come on, render. Oh, okay, so it renders, shows you 3 tabs, fully working. Let's just go back to the men one just to show you that the thing is a live interface. And so like the entire thing like vaguely works as it does on the site or the app or whatever. And it's a good enough reference for these guys. And what they'll do then is, so what they can then do is, oh, no, you know what, for tomorrow we are going to be taking this banner off and maybe pushing it down here instead. I sure would like the carousel of thing to come on top somewhere. But I have a ending tag, so you can use both styles of tags. That you don't need the slash carousel. And you do this, and you click save. Oh, wait, so let's like piss off some people at work. Let's say that clothing is, let's just say, 40% off for JS Foo volunteers with bald heads. Anyone who matches that, can I just say save and see who gives me a phone call in the next 5 minutes? What is showing up on the app? Oh, fine, I'm just going to close that. Sorry about that. But the idea is that, okay, so I've done this much so far. And I want to like open it up because, frankly, I don't know what I'm doing. And so I'll be putting it out on GitHub today on my repo. There's no like package publish and all, but you're free to like do a require, use these libraries, and like start doing fancy shit with like layouts and all. Solves a real enough problem for us, and it establishes a rhythm. Okay, so remember, like there's no such thing about a framework. The React thing is completely optional, but it establishes a framework for how we deal with content in our office or wherever else. Like I want to do something. It's not a haphazard, okay, fine, data store and API and all that jazz, but there's a story through the thing. You like make like conscious decisions about what your content is going to be like, what it's going to talk to, and you can add on extra stuff, of course, like just like simple service calls and components, and it ends up working across platforms, and the damn thing works on IE8, which is cool. It's fairly secure. You're never going to be able to post to that endpoint. If you can, like, that's cool, I guess. You get 40% off. And that's what I'm like looking forward to now. I've suddenly seem to have like walked across this thing where I can now solve a bunch of front-ender problems in my office like really quickly. Oh, fine, you have a bunch of data that you want to solve. Oh, you're making premium shop layouts. Okay, fine, just store it this way. Here's your admin UI to it, and here are the APIs for it. In about half an hour, the guy is actually building the app instead of waiting for a back-end guy to give him database access. And he can move to another database later. That's also cool. Like you can do migrations and stuff like that. But frankly, it's just a dump. You're using the database store as a dump. The intelligent stuff is happening in real time with like Elasticsearch and these transforms and stuff like that. So yeah, I'll be open sourcing it today. And open sourcing, I'm just pushing it to GitHub. Yeah, like now, whatever. Like I think I have some swear words in that. And my boss cares about things like that. But anyway, that's it. And that was my demo. Oh, I had that slide. And I'm open to like questions about it. What do you think? Does it work? Oh. I don't know if that means yes or get off the stage. Oh, yeah, questions. Yeah, sure.
So you have these...
You can shout. Haven't you had breakfast today?
Hey, so you have this server side, you have this JSX which is also passed on the server side.
Sure.
And then you generate your queries based on that, your Elasticsearch queries on that basis?
Basically, yeah. So the Elasticsearch will like parse the generated JSON, not the JSX itself.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. So it gives me like chance to do a bunch of stuff, this transform callback, not just like generate JSON.
Okay.
But for example, I can run like term extraction on it and get a bunch of interesting terms, like the sports tip thing.
Okay.
Like I'll say like, yeah, just add Nike, looking through our brands, which are Nike.
Okay.
And that is what Elasticsearch will think, will actually talk to.
Okay.
So then by the time like I'm in production, no one's even talking to my database. It's just Elasticsearch and Varnish or whatever.
Okay. So the stuff that you're going to open source, it has this bit as well?
Which bit?
I mean, like the query part to Elasticsearch.
Ah, yeah. So like the Elasticsearch thing, I'm like, I've never like really used it. So I've been experimenting with it.
Mm-hmm.
But in a sense, like, you know what to do.
Yeah.
There's API endpoints which give you each key value. You get all the list of the keys and you shove it into Elasticsearch and magic, you have search.
Okay. And you have these three product queries and then the search query. Do you bunch these queries up or like what does it do now? I mean, like you do like product search one, product search two, product search three together.
Oh, no. Okay. So for those three single ones, so it does all of these asynchronously.
Okay.
It sets up promises on all of that, does the service calls. Once they get together, spit the JSON out.
Okay.
So product is product service.
Okay.
Yeah, it's asynchronous.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Okay.
Any more questions?
So was really good performance one of your aims in building this?
Was performance?
Yeah, like, you know, CMS that's responsive. And when I say responsive, not in terms of media queries.
Sure, but that's just it. Like, it boils down to what you want to do with your content. Do you want live queries? Then you'd better be okay with, like, more service law, this thing. Or, like, you figure out a way to pre-generate it and put it into Elasticsearch and all that. Performance is, like, that's why I, like, have that as one section. Delivery is a whole other plan altogether. But right now, am I able to create, manipulate it, manage it for non-techies and actually like have a good API to read it? That was my major concern.
Because Redis seems to be like the perfect backend for this.
You can use Redis to make an adapter. Any more questions?
Generate this JSX from this server side? I mean, you have this bunch of React render components on this thing.
So I store the JSX to database.
Yes.
And like I'm running it on the server side in a VM.
Okay.
And using Require VM.
Why VM?
Because I'm running JavaScript on the server that other people are typing. I have to be secure about that.
Okay.
Any more questions? Anything?
Sunil.
Yeah.
Hey, where do you hire marketing guys who can write JSX?
Oh. So this is the thing, okay? This is the thing seniority gives you in the company. You don't have to ask anymore. You say, this is how it's happening. So that's how I make it work. They're like, okay, fine. What is it, this angle thing and all that? And it's fairly simple. Like, I don't care about them writing the JavaScript in it. I just wanted, like, the HTML thing. The JavaScript part is like total bonus for me to play with. I did a couple of experiments where I was able to generate custom banners which said like, welcome Sunil and all that. But I figured that would piss people off if I knew who was coming. But whatever. Any more questions? Did that answer your question? Okay, all right. So, sorry, like it was totally rushed and I'm running out of time and tech. So you can totally come up to me, talk to me about it. I'm going to be working on just this and figuring out where I can reach with it. Happy to talk to anyone who has any ideas about it. Thank you for your time. Enjoy lunch.